Okay, now we'll see the design of triangular waveform generator. There are a couple of steps which you have to just carry out and then you'll get the circuit design. Okay, so we are supposed to generate 1 kilohertz, 2 volt peak to peak. Remember, 2 volt peak to peak means minus 2 to plus 2. Triangular waveform, you have to use the supply plus minus 15 volts, and as usual we start with having the maximum bias current of the operational amplifier to 100 nanoamperes. Now we start with the solution. The solution is composed of two parts designed naturally, one for integrator and the other for the Schmidt trigger. So we start with the step one, that is the integrator design. So first of all, we have to start with, let us say we have this polarity. So I1. So we have a specific requirement of I1, because I1 is supposed to be far more greater than IB max. So we start, always we start, most of the designs you have seen, we already started with the design saying that the current over here, the current flowing here into this R1 for example, is far more greater than IB max. So I will assume I1 to be far more greater than IB max. So select I1. As let us say, now the more the better, so let us say 1000 times IB max. Generally we take 100, but here in this case we are taking 1000. Anything more than 100 we also do. So that turns out to be, so what is I1? I1 turns out to be 100 microamperes. Okay, now once we have this current, what is the voltage that is at this end of R1 when it is plus Vsat? Now basically, what is Vsat? Vsat is either VCC, 90% of VCC is equal to Vsat, or rather Vsat is 90% of VCC. Now most of the times, to have simple calculations, what we do is we take Vsat as VCC directly minus 1 volt. This also is one valid design assumption, or let us say calculation. Okay, generally it turns out to be nearly about 1.5 volts. Okay, so Vsat we are taking as VCC equal to minus 1, VCC being 15 volts, my Vsat will be 14 volts. Many of the books they use this, otherwise standard practices Vsat is equal to 90% of VCC. Okay, anyways, we will use the assumption over here. So now you have the voltage over here, voltage across the resistor and current flowing through the resistor. And what is the voltage at this point? It is equal to 0 volts. Why? Because it is at a virtual ground. Why? Because the non-inverting terminal is at ground, and so that is the reason why inverting input also is at the same potential, which is ground. So voltage across R1 is Vsat, current flowing through R1 is I1. It is easy for us to find out what is R1. So R1 happens to be Vsat divided by I1. So that is equal to 14 volts divided by 100 microamperes, which turns out to be 140 kilo-ohms. The 140 kilo-ohms is not a standard value, so we will use a 120 kilo-ohm resistor instead. Alright? So our selection of R1, calculation of R1 is through. So I will just make more space over here. Okay. So now going for step 2. Now since we have already taken a different value than the calculated value, we may have to recalculate the value of I1. So recalculate I1, which happens to be 14 volts divided by the selected value of resistor, that is 120 kilo-ohms, which turns out to be 107 microamperes. Okay, just to verify that this is a larger quantity than IB max. Step 3. Now, we already have seen that whatever is the difference between that is the delta V, that is if you like do it this way again. So we have already seen this was the output voltage and this was the delta V. So it was here, if you remember, it was UTP, here it was LTP. So naturally speaking, the delta V, that is the voltage change in the output of VO1, is UTP minus LTP, that happens to be 2 volts minus minus 2 volts, that gives me 4 volts. Step 4. So this is the change in the output voltage. What is the time period? It is actually this time, okay, plus for example this time. So T1, T2. Okay, so whatever is the time taken by the ramp in the negative direction and the ramp taken by the positive direction. So that happens to be 1 upon 2 times F. That is 1 divided by 2 into 1 kilovolts. Why 2F here in this case? It is half of that time taken by the ramp. For example, let us say the total time period T is 1 by F. So this particular T1 that is taken up is T by 2. That is the reason why I get T1 as, or T itself as 1 by 2 times F. So that turns out to be, what is this time? Turns out to be equal to 500 microseconds. Okay. Proceeding to the next step. Step 5. Now we will use a simple equation for voltage across the capacitor and the current flowing through it, the relationship between the voltage across the capacitor, which happens to be V or delta V is the current into time divided by the capacitance. This is a quite simple equation which we have seen so many times. Using this equation, I can calculate C1, which is I1 into T divided by delta V. So using this, I can say C1 is equal to 117 microamperes. Don't forget I1 is different, into, we have recalculated it, into 500 microseconds divided by 4 volts. Delta V happens to be 4 volts. This turns out to be 0.0146 microfarads. Not a standard value, so you use a standard value 0.015 microfarad. Alright. Now step 6. This starts with the Schmitt trigger design. So we will start with a fresh page here. So step 6 is the Schmitt trigger design. Again, here we have I2, so we have to select I2 far more greater than IV max. Therefore, I2 happens to be, let us say again, 100 microampere, jump steps here in this case, 1000 into 100 nanoamperes, that gives me 100 microamperes. So now in this case, I can find out the value of R3 here, because I know the voltage at this point, voltage at this point, and the current flowing through this R3 is also I2. So I can find out R3 as Vsat divided by I2. Again, that turns out to be 14 volts divided by 100 microampere. This turns out to be again 140 kilo ohms. Standard you can use as 120 kilo ohms. Again, recalculating I2, so I2, actual value of I2 is again the same thing, 117 microamperes. Step 7, R2, now we have seen the design of the Schmitt trigger, so R2 happens to be what? UTP by I2, simple. This turns out to be 2 volts divide by 117 microampere, which gives me 17.1 kilo ohms. You have to use, let us say, standard 18 kilo ohm resistor. Okay, that actually finishes the calculation of R1, C1, R2 and R3. Now, one most important step which people normally don't care about but is important is the minimum slew rate that is required by the operational amplifier. And that is the last step of the design, step 8. Calculate slew rate, required slew rate. Slew rate, all of you know, is given as 2 pi f Vp divided by 10 to the power 6. This is volts per microseconds. So that turns out to be 2 into pi into frequency is 1 kilohertz and you have peak value as 2 volts, that divided by 10 to the power 6, and this happens to be equal to 0.012 volts per microseconds. Now, to ensure the performance of the integrator, we have to make sure one important thing, that the slew rate should be selected far more, let us say, equal to 100 times the minimum slew rate requirement. Okay, this ensures a good performance. So the minimum slew rate is what we have calculated. So the required slew rate is simply 100 into 0.012 volts per microseconds, that turns out to be 1.2 volts per microseconds. So this is the minimum slew rate that is required for the operational amplifier. This finishes the design of the triangular waveform generator. I would want all of you to work out this design using multisim and verify the performance. Thank you.